All right, so this is a one-off community meeting where we're trying to shape up and define what KubeVirt version 1 should look at like. So we're planning for KubeVirt version 1, which we're hoping lands this year, so pretty soon. We just need to define what that is and kind of set the goalposts for ourselves so we know what we're working towards. So to begin with, I think it would make sense for us to take a look at what version 1 means. I wrote down my thoughts, and it's okay if you don't have any other thoughts, but at least let's try to agree on something. And what I've kind of tried to use as our definition is version 1, it should be the minimal functionality we think it's necessary to meet our goal of being an infrastructure as a service virtual machine management platform that's ready for production use. And I think that this means that in order for it to be ready for production use, we're going to have an established process for community support and a user guide that's easily accessible and formatted in a way that people can use easily. So, what are people's thoughts about how I've defined this? Does that make sense to everyone? Is that a good kind of just general goal? Is there anything we should add, remove, or anything? Whatever you, any thoughts you all have, we can go anywhere with this. They'll speak at once.
I had something. I'm not sure that it is maybe strictly required for version one, but something that I definitely would like to see in the future is a well-defined, maybe we can call it an interface for Virt launcher and Virt handler. So,
Yeah.
yeah.
Okay, we'll get to that.
I want to add something to what Daniel said.
Yeah.
We also know we need to, I want to elaborate on the storage side, on the way you create VMs and how you attach storage to it. There are so many ways to do it. It can be confusing sometimes.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. So you're coming kind of from a communication standpoint, so how we communicate to people how to create virtual machines, or are you saying that we need to potentially look at streamlining? Maybe go into some more detail there, like how could we what actions could we take to simplify this for people?
We can, I mean, we can, since there are a few ways to do it, we should stick to one way to do it on one method and expose this to the users to prevent mistakes and misconfigurations in the future. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I'm not sure. So, our API is pretty complicated because it's kind of flexible and it's fairly powerful, but it gives us a lot of options. So it sounds like what you're talking about might be something similar to what OpenShift has done with the common templates, where they give kind of a, this is how you can create a virtual machine and just fill out a few variables and all the complicated stuff is just hidden behind the scenes. Is that
Yes.
similar? Okay.
Yeah, similar to what you described.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to add that to the list. That's something we've been thinking about. So at the bottom of the list, I would define that as it's almost like a templating mechanism for virtual machines. So I said templating mechanism for virtual machines, and this is going to be something that extracts away some of the API complexities from users. And conceptually, we would consider this to be something similar to what we get with OpenShift templating, except of course we'd want this to be available to everyone, regardless if you're using OpenShift. So something that's generically available for anyone who's using KubeVirt.
Thanks for writing it.
Excellent. So it sounds like we didn't have a whole lot to talk about in the definition.
I may have one thing. I feel this commitment issue whenever software goes to V1, because you want it to be perfect when you go out with V1, right? So you don't need to add anything else then. So the bucket can just grow and grow. And KubeVirt will be never done, right? So for me, as a user, I would expect one single thing from KubeVirt going V1, and that's like perfect documentation. So if I have an issue, I can just find the user story that tells me, or the user guide, how to do it. But I don't think that we really need any of these other bullet points. I just want this documentation, and anything else can go in 1.1 and 1.2 and just come in the future. So, I mean, I'm okay with all these points, but I would be also okay just dropping them and leaving it just for docs.
So I think we're in agreement that anything that's user, especially people's first interaction with our project, we need to make that just awesome. That needs to be, they can find the information they need, it's concise, and it's easy to consume, because that's how we gain traction. And we're gonna have a lot of eyes on us once we make an announcement like KubeVirt is version 1. So that's an opportunity for us to gain traction as well. So I would say it's priority 1. I would agree that we need to take a hard look at our user guide and what's available to people that are first approaching the project, make sure that they're funneled in a way that makes it easy for them to access the information that they need. So yeah, that's definitely doesn't need to be cut. I would agree.
Yeah, I mean, while writing the docs for like, writing all the user guides we can think about, like once you start doing it, you will figure out what are the, like you will see clearly when KubeVirt lacks some user experience features. You know, if you need to write a long as user guide on one feature, it probably means that you need to rethink the feature. And so I focus solely on that. I mean, like the, for instance, the Virt Launcher live updates, it sounds like something that's like a cool feature, but I don't think it's a mandatory. But I think that KubeVirt is pretty useful even without that. And we can just keep trimming the list of items there.
Yeah, I would like to add to what Petr just said about the launcher live updates. The reference to control plane components here, I'm not sure if it is 100% accurate, because unlike control plane components, which can be, for example, compared to Virt Handler or something like that, but Virt Launcher is a user defined workload, more like a pod. So yeah, I'm not sure that this feature is strictly required for V1.
Go ahead. Thinking, as a potential user and the scope of V1 being production ready, correct me if I'm wrong, but this Virt Launcher live update is kind of important in the sense that you can upgrade, you can perform updates while keeping VMs not impacted, correct?
Here's why this is in here. Virt Launcher pods, or the VMI pods, they contain our control plane component, which is Virt Launcher, but also contains libvirt and qmu. And if anyone wants to update those components, it's tied to the workload. So we were looking at ways to perhaps seamlessly figure out a way to kind of inject those new components into that pod and maybe cycle the virtual machine in a way that it's not disruptive and things like that.
I mean, sorry to interrupt, but beyond the technical details, I would say, so from a user's point of view, and Daniel, I think you did the last comment, or Peter, I'm not sure, but you said, okay, this is like a pod. Well, it's not, it's a VM running inside the pod, right? And if, you know, for a Kubernetes, like a normal pod upgrades, pods are expected to be killed and you know, restarted. That's probably not the same expectation if you run a VM, right?
Yes. So I agree with you. Yeah, okay, please.
Now go for it, Daniel.
No, Pep, please.
Ah, so I mean, and I think that here we can make a, like, there's a difference between the pet VMs and like the kettle VMs, right? So if we say that we want to support pet VMs in V1, then we probably need live updates and we need snapshots. But if we are fine with the kettle, which are like, they are more like pods, then we can drop these two items from V1 because it's, you know, it's not necessarily part of the scope.
I think we, I want to take a step back. So this task item is talking about live updating a Virt launcher. I think that's going to be, that's too much. What we need is just to at least, the very minimum, have a clearly documented or a process for updating these Virt launcher pods. So even if that means that if you want to update them, you have to live migrate or you have to shut down and start up again, or whatever. We just need a process that defines that today, because right now it's kind of, you update your KubeVirt version and it's not obvious that these things are left around with the old version. The workload components are left with the old version. It's not even obvious what you need to do to update these things. Even if we can't do the live update, it's gonna be pretty difficult, I think. At the very minimum, I think we need to either have a mechanism that automatically triggers the update, or at least document and make it explicit that you're in charge of updating your workloads at this point. Does that make sense? Do you think that covers at least what we need coming out of the gate?
Yes, absolutely. Well, for me, yes.
Okay. So I'm gonna make a point here. So I think I'm just going to start going down this list, and we'll tackle these things one by one, and hopefully we'll get to the bottom of this list. We've already knocked out a few, and that should give us a good indication of what we're targeting here. So the first thing on this list, we have the core KubeVirt APIs need to go to version 1, and I think that's, we've already essentially, we already are kind of version 1. It's just we're version 1 alpha 3 right now for historical reasons. It's because there were some issues in previous Kubernetes versions that made it difficult for us to have multi-version support in the way that we wanted. It was stable, and we've just hit the point in the past probably 6 months where we feel comfortable doing that, but then we've been held back by some other things. So I think we're at a point where we are effectively version 1. We just need to actually flip the version to actually represent what we are. But as part of this, we're saying that we need to rely on the general availability Kubernetes entities. So when we register our CRDs, they need to actually be registered using CRD version 1. That's the KubeVirt object itself. And we need everything that comes along with that. So we need to have the explain functionality. We also need to have the schema validation reintroduced back into that CRD as well. So just fully fledged, we're using the CRD API in its entirety as part of the criteria. Anyone have any problems with that one? I think that one is pretty obvious that we just have to do.
Just to get it clear, this is not a chance to deprecate some APIs and rework the way. Gotcha.
Okay. No. So we're looking at being forward, moving forward. So what we have now, we would be just moving forward and backwards compatible. So the current V1 alpha 3 would be an alias for V1, essentially. They're just going to be the same thing. And V1 alpha 3, it's not going away. It'll always exist. It'll just be the same thing as V1. So anyone who's invested in their V1 alpha 3 API, and they have perhaps virtual machines that use that group and kind or whatever, everything would just continue to work. Anything else before we move on? Okay, so the next one is snapshot support. And I think it doesn't really matter what we think about this because it's so close that it'll probably just make it in. Maybe Michael is the one that might have some strong opinions about this. I would say this is optional. Does anyone disagree?
Do we need it on the list then?
I would say that again. I might have missed.
What do we need it on the list if it's optional?
No, I think we can. So we have an deferred from version 1 list here at the bottom. It has no entries, but I would move that. I'm going to go ahead and move it. If anyone has any objections, speak now.
What about the non-root VMI pods?
So before we move on to the next one, sorry, not an objection, but just a question. What could depend on the snapshots? I'm wondering things like backups, probably.
Yeah, so if people want to back up and restore their virtual machines, it would depend on using snapshots.
Well, okay. I will not object about deferring it, but I just wanted to add a note that, keeping this production ready context, backups are important for production. So anyway, let's move on.
Okay. So, all right, non-root, who brought that up? Let's talk about it.
I did. And my question is, why is it something that is like strictly required for version 1? Why it can't be something like version 1 dot something?
Yeah, it can be. That's what we're discussing. So I think it's a perception issue right now. People would like to have their virtual machine workloads running in the least privileged pod possible. I don't know if that really matters for version 1. I think we can continue to work towards that non-root VMI pods without it necessarily being something that we have to get done for version 1. But what do you all think? It sounds like, Daniel, you seem to agree that maybe it's not required.
It's Ezra. Can I add something? So I think it's clearly noticed that this is untrusted area. As you actually said, it is problematic on one hand to specify it's untrusted and to give root privilege to the pod. So I think it is advisable either to indicate that it's kind of work in progress, or remove the root.
So in indicating this, would this be part of our user guide? How would you expect us to communicate this?
I don't know. I'm just saying that, you know, it's clearly divided between, you know, we're trying to divide between untrusted and trusted, right? And you have the handler on one side, the launcher, and then you have it on untrusted area, but you basically give it root, and through root, I can elevate, I can do a lot of damage. So it's kind of, you break the border between the untrusted and trusted with that.
But one thing that I'd like to add here, it's not like we're giving the user access to a root pod. Well, the user is still inside a VM. So he still
absolutely
needs to break from the VM. It is possible.
Absolutely.
Hard.
Absolutely. We are talking about the case of VM break. Right. Absolutely. So maybe it gives some indications in case of VM break, which is, you know, we know it's a rare occasion. That's my only point.
So here's what I'm getting. Maybe non-root VMI pods don't need to be targeted for version one, but at the very least, we need to have a documented trust model for what our components are allowed to do and exactly where we fall as far as privileges. Would that make sense?
Sorry. Yes. I have one question, though, that just came to my mind. So actually, if I'm giving, so let's say that I'm a cluster admin and I'm giving you, David, the option to create VMs on your namespace. I'm giving you a namespace and you can create VMs there. So you can also exec in the launcher pod, right?
Yeah.
So if you can do it that, so it is a problem because I'm basically giving you root access to one of my nodes.
Kind of.
So maybe it is.
I think there's some ways to prevent that. Like for example, in OpenShift, the security context constraints wouldn't let you pod exec into a pod that had privileges that you as a user don't have. So you couldn't pod exec into the Virt launcher pod. But in vanilla Kubernetes, I'm not sure if the, what is it called? The policy.
I think you can remove the exec. The question is, do you need it? Do you need exec into the launcher? If not, you can remove it.
Sure, right. So that's the other option.
We just need to make sure that the user, that the regular user can't exec into the launcher. And then...
That's not something we can necessarily enforce, but that's something that whoever's setting up KubeVirt and however they've set their multi-tenancy should have to enforce somehow with RDAP or whatever.
I don't know, because with this problem where regular users can exec into launcher pods, and it is something that we even if we document it somewhere, it is a huge security risk. So maybe it is something that should go into version one.
I'm writing that down. Okay, I think that's something that we need to investigate, our messaging around this and what recommendations we have at the very least for how users should be able to create virtual machines and what privileges they should be able to have within the cluster to avoid this. So I think this is from a messaging standpoint right now. We need to understand the trust model and then make some recommendations for people to be able to limit users' ability to gain elevated privileges. Or we could do we could say non-root pods is required for version one. I don't know. What are we leaning towards here?
I think that if the only if our only option is to document it to avoid this, so we should require it for version one, because documentation is not a solution in this case, because it is a security issue, a big security issue.
Not necessarily, because you know it's the option of the user, right? If you have a very well defined documentation of the trust model, it's up to me to decide whether I want to use that in production. My problem currently is because it's not well documented, it's kind of misleading, right? I see this nice model of trust and trust. I don't want to dig into a lot of documentation to get the answer that, oh, I have a root on the pod. I want it to be clear. And it's not, there are many cases in which it's completely fine. It's a completely fine model.
It is not just root on the pod, because if I'm a privileged pod, I can easily access to other pods.
It should be privileged. We enable privileged for, I think it might have been SRBO, and maybe that's even gone now. We shouldn't have a problem with that anymore. I can double check.
Yeah, we are not privileged, but you still have, you can access the, you can edit the networking within the Virt launcher, and by doing that, you may be able to destroy networking for all the other pods that run the same node, for instance. So this risk is still there.
The only way privileged gets set today is if somebody's using PowerPC, and that was because of a some issue with LibVirt, but that's the only way it would get set.
Yeah, but it is also something, because but maybe I agree here with Ezra. If we like add a very large warning on the documentation or on the installation, on the install documentation. But the problem is that people can consume KubeVirt, for example, through the OpenShift app registry, because we deploy our releases there as well.
I mean, even with the documentation, like we will have only one V1 and we can make a big boom. And if I open the documentation of KubeVirt and see, oh, yes, this works, but it's not secure, then it's like, going away.
I agree.
Okay.
Maybe we should solve it.
Let's do it. All right. So that one stays. That's going to be tough.
Maybe you should leave the comments and just write our decision at the end, because people can ask again and have this.
Go back through.
I'm not super concerned about this one. Executing into pods and creating VM are two different. Really sets of permissions, and you know, regular users don't necessarily have to exec into pods.
I'm not worried about this from a practical standpoint, really at all. I'm worried about this entirely from a perception standpoint.
I don't know. I mean, I've installed a lot of Kubernetes applications, and a lot of them, you know, are privileged without saying anything about it, or do a lot of. You know,
which doesn't mean it's a good thing for them.
And on upstream, you know, it's kind of root by default anyway.
Again, which doesn't mean it's a good thing.
Does this have potential to damage our version one offering? So if we come out of the gate with version one and then we talk about root privileges and things like this, my impression is that that's going to instill some sort of doubt. And whether that doubt is founded in reality or not, I'd prefer, if we can pull it off, to just not even have to go down that path. I think that's kind of what we're leaning towards, at least right now. Yeah. Any other thoughts on this? We don't have to completely commit to something right this moment, but I'm inclined to leave it on the list for now and maybe continue this discussion if we find that it's not viable for us to go non-route in a reasonable time period, then maybe we'll open this back up and say, I think this is going to hold us back from version one too long. Maybe we should look at some of these documentation or how we communicate this instead. Does that sound good? Okay.
Works for me.
Excellent. Great discussion. I think this was a good one. So the next one on the list is this persistent containerized volumes with QCAL deltas. I put this one on here, and the only reason I did this was from a community traction perspective. So when somebody approaches a project for the first time, everyone uses container disks because it's the easiest way to just start their first virtual machine and see it working, and they don't have to think about how to import their virtual machine root disk and all that. So the idea with persistent container disks is we would give somebody an option immediately when they're just trying to play around with KubeVirt to use the fully fledged features that they get with KubeVirt, being able to stop and start virtual machines, and potentially if we have like snapshots enabled by then, they'd be able to snapshot and restore. And so it's not something that I necessarily see. I think some people will use it in production, but I see it as something that users will definitely take advantage of with their first interactions with KubeVirt. What do you all think? Is this one important or not?
I agree it's important. I think most people, to get community engagement, you have to be able to go to the project and instantly have something working and see the benefits. So anything to assist in that will get more people to use it and contribute as well.
Cool. Yeah.
Especially if it's low hanging fruit and something simple to do.
I think it's pretty easy for us as well. I think it's an easy win. So it's not going to take a lot of effort from us to get this to work.
Hello, this is Fabian from Reddit. About this one, I totally see it's a useful feature, but why would we make it a part of the MVP for V1?
My thought was, so when we make noise about version one, we're going to have, I hope, new people checking out the project. And if it's the first time engaging with the project, if we have a clear path for them to just start virtual machines in a persistent way and stop them, and they can just get things to work immediately, then it's a path for us to gain traction with this person. If they see this just easy, then they won't give up. So you have about, I think, maybe 5 minutes, really, with somebody checking out something new. They should be able to install it without any issue. And then you have a couple of minutes of them playing around with it before they're going to give up. So I see this as a way of allowing them to have a good first experience. But what do you think, Fabian?
My whole worry about container disks is really, I mean, I totally understand the use case of having, like, you know, well-crafted and curated container disks, right? Like everything we know. But it does not scale if you come up with your custom VM images, right? I know plenty of users who have like 20 gig size VM images, 100 gigs, right? Or even larger VM images. And that's where container disks fail, right? The registries are not tuned towards this with like these large blobs. I know of issues where like huge Java binaries crash registries in the past. And I see the same issue that people will get the wrong expectations about VMs, right? I have the worry that I have that ever since, right? And that people get the wrong impression of this delivery mechanism. It is well suited for crafted images, but it's not a good mechanism for custom images that you prepare outside, right? If you know the constraints, right? But not for, again, if you have a Windows VM, put databases and all the Java stuff inside of it, it will be too fat for registry. It's not suited. And that is why I have my reservations about setting the wrong expectations on such a feature.
So let's say you're encountering KubeVirt for the first time. How would you, you know our whole feature set, you know the whole ecosystem. How would you communicate to this person who's starting their first virtual machine? Where to get the disk, where to consume it, how to do this? Would you, I won't say anything else.
I think, to be honest, I think what would make the story clearer, in my opinion, more versatile, is to say container disks are great for, you know, stateless workloads, right? That's a great story because it's better, right? And anything that requires persistence, we require the VM image to be on a PVC. And for that, in order to achieve that, right? Today we know we could use CDI, but that's cumbersome to a certain degree because you need to install CDI in advance to cure it. So for example, one thing I could imagine which would also achieve this way to simply do, rewind back a little bit is, I think if we say, now you want to do a persistent VM, right? Copy this or make it, I don't know the wording, right? So bear with me on the wording. Copy this container disk to PVC and you can use it as a persistent VM, right? And CDI is doing it. So by including CDI, getting CDI closer to KubeVirt, including certain parts in order to make this easy, right? Simply put a container disk on a PV. I think that would help because then it's clear. Oh, it's a PV, it's a persistent volume. Oh yeah, clear. Yeah, absolutely. That's clear, right? So the words already imply that persistence is so much clearer. And you know then, you know, the user is also getting the idea, oh, so I can create a PV to modify my VM. I can upload random VMs at arbitrary sizes and PVs are suited for bigger sizes, right? Two PVs. All right, that makes sense, right? So making it easier to move a container disk to a PV to get started could be something that I think could help to solve that problem differently.
So I understand what you're getting at. My concerns here is we've already introduced in the first few seconds that somebody is looking at this project, we've introduced another project, so CDI. So somebody is
saying, why I said it today, it's a PETA, right? But that's why I said the different option to have persistence is by pulling CDI in or, you know, leveraging it differently. But yes, as part, it needs to be part of KubeVirt. The ability to have a container disk on a PV needs to be part of core KubeVirt.
Right. Let's talk about that. So do you think that we should bundle CDI with KubeVirt?
I would see that as an option, right? I mean, we discuss here, right? I want to make sure that I explain my problem with that story about the persistent on container disk and the wrong expectations about, you know, the versatility, if you could say it that way, of container disks. And that for persistent, I would rather like to focus on PVCs. And everything we do with PVs today centered around CDI. So yes, right, if we say that story is, if we agree, right, that for persistence, PVs are a better story, then we can look at options. And one of the options would be pull CDI closer to KubeVirt, incorporate it directly, make it a core controller, for example, to not have it stand alone, but be part, be built into KubeVirt, because then we eliminate the problem that it's an external dependency.
I don't want to talk about CDI. In this initial, like, I want them to use CDI and I want that to be happening behind the scenes. But in the first few, like, we're talking about people's first interactions with it, I want it to be KubeVirt and I want a simple manifest and I want it to be streamlined where they just do the thing and it works. And if that CDI working behind the scenes, that's great. But we need to streamline how we package and deliver that with KubeVirt.
But
I have a question, Fabian, and just to understand your point. So you want to disallow completely the usage of a persistent container disk?
No, it'll make it in. It's more of how we
Right, but if it makes it, wait, but if it makes it in and you still have some images on which you cannot use it, that's a problem.
Okay. That's my point, exactly.
So so you cannot leave it and let the user kind of suddenly need to understand that you need to move to CDI, right? You need
upfront. documentation, as we covered in other.
No.
Right. So either you explicitly defined, give some limit to the image size, or you disallow, or you, if you go to CDI, just disallow the other option. You cannot leave it.
One option, right? If we ignore CDI, another option, for example, and my point is here, I just want to highlight the problem, and I cannot come up with a solution in 2 minutes or five or seven. So one option is, right, we could say we have a similar API, which is referencing a container disk, right? But instead of, you know, putting it into an empty DR on the node, right, we at the same time reference a PV, and what KubeVirt is doing for us, it's putting down the PVC and putting it on the PV, and we launch the VM from the PV. Right, so it's effectively a subset of what CDI does, simply built into the KubeVirt API for, I think, something like a seed image, right? The seed image, which is put on the PVC, and then we're done, right? Then you only need the API, put it on the PV, and that's it. I'm not saying it's good, right? I just want to say there are different options. And Ezra, I agree, actually, we should actually put up limits on the container disks in order to prevent that people are abusing it. Like, I think there's no question that we should an upper limit of 100 gig on a kcal, which should be put into a container image because it's killing the registry.
Yeah, but that's not something we necessarily need to enforce. I mean, if their registry lets them update or upload a 100 gig container image, then they can use it. I don't know what the limits are necessarily.
Fair point. We can check with common registries. Yeah,
I think it's easy enough to just say, you know, you're limited by what your registry allows you to upload here, and here's another path for you if you need to consider this. I don't necessarily think that this is a problem for this initial user who's just wanting to play around with KubeVirt for the first time. Sure, it's a problem for somebody who's making a production usage out of KubeVirt, but if they're doing that, surely they are investing a little bit more time than the 5 minutes that they used to install and run a virtual machine on Minikube.
By the way, you run into, the problem is if we strengthen this feature too much, I think we run into problems of the, you know, of the course of the lifetime of the project, because like a 100 gigabyte image, one problem is like the registry side. And I think it's already a problem like with Docker Hub today or Quay, right? But on the other side, actually, we then also have the requirement that nodes are limited by their storage size, right? So you can have that 100 gig image, but you need to pull it down to the node. You need to have it there, right? Even only if you want to run the overlay. So I really don't think that this technical solution is scalable to the images, and that we put the users on the wrong track, right? I think we focus them on the, on a, in my opinion, non-scalable or non-future-proof solution, right? Because I think PVs are, when it comes to persistence and huge VMs, superior.
Yeah, I think that container disks are a great feature to demo KubeVirt, and this is, I think, what it was meant for initially. And we even have a set of examples in the examples directory. And I think that what Fabian suggested in the beginning, that it somehow connects to what you, David, said, that what will be the initial experience of a user with KubeVirt. And I think that making something like, okay, welcome to KubeVirt, here is a container disk and you can deploy it, but this is a demo. And we show him a very small subset of what KubeVirt can do. And then, like every demo, right? You don't show everything. You just show some few basic highlights. And then you can tell the user, so if you want the full KubeVirt experience, you need persistency.
I think that contradicts actually the definition that David put. Because the definition is the version one of production. So it's not a demo, it's a version one, it's a first impression of the production. And I think the problem coming from the different view Fabian and David, because David, you are saying first impression, and Fabian correctly say, okay, if the first impression was good, I want to continue, right? And now I'm stuck with something that is not scalable. I don't want in a half a year to go back and starting to change stuff because I choose the wrong stuff. On the other end, I don't want too complicated process to start with. So it's kind of a trade-off. I think that if we can guarantee that someone knows, not a demo and not so on, but he knows that this is kind of a intermediate or something that is limited for the future, you can still allow it. But we need to clearly make sure he doesn't stick with that forever, right?
Yeah, and I think that is why I said, I think it's definitely something, I mean, there's no question that we want to keep container disks, right? Because they're so cool to get started. And that's why I said, you know, let's see how we can connect them, right? How there's a small delta to get them on the track where they get to the versatile solution PBs, right? And that's why I had that idea, and I don't know how the implementation would look, but to say, okay, now do this small change, you can still pull it this way, but you will end up with something that is first giving you persistence for this specific image. But at the same time, you get on track, PVs are my way to go to do persistence in large VMs, right?
Yeah, but you're still, it's the same track. So the limiting factor here is the container disk itself. So we're talking about putting too large of information inside of container disk. So if they're going down the path and their first interaction was the container disk, then we're saying that that's a problem, then I don't see how we're solving anything by not letting them use a PVC backing container disk or directly importing that container disk onto a PVC itself. Like, I don't see where either of these things really matter. It's the same. It's just the same. It's the same problem. We're just packaging it in two different ways. That's all we're talking about here.
Sorry. Could you? I think I lost.
Are we saying that container disks themselves are the problem? So placing a container, a virtual machine image in a container image and uploading that to a registry, is that the problem that we're saying people are going to encounter? That pattern is one they're going to encounter as they move forward years later.
I think there are a couple of technical problems, right? So the registry is one of them, right? And the aspects when it comes to using this non-shared storage from pulling it back to the node, for example. The then expectation to you know, that everything is built, that, I mean, by introducing this persistency on PVs, right? The overlay persistence on PVs, we still focus the delivery path, we effectively say our primary path to delivering base images or OS images is container disk, right? I think with adding the persistency to container disk, we really highlight this feature. And that is what I think is wrong, because the container disk approach, in my opinion, is not versatile. It does not support network storage. For live migration, we also need to, let's not get into live migration, but I think because we don't, to me it's important, because I think it's the right technical thing, is to focus on PVs to be the versatile storage mechanism for virtual machine disks, for data disks and OS disks. And we don't get this component into the picture if we stick to the container disk only path, right? It is somehow as an overlay.
Here's the issue. The first interaction somebody has with KubeVirt, they're going to want to say, how do I get my image into this system? I've got an image. Mm-hmm. And if they're stuck spinning their wheels just on this, they're not going to move past that. So that's why we say use container disk as your first interaction, get the thing up and going, and that's a path that you can take. Yeah. But if we're saying that, it doesn't matter if we're saying that their first interaction is using a container disk that they put directly on a PVC using CDI, or they're using a container disk and we're making a backing volume using a PVC, that's irrelevant really, because they're starting with the container disk still.
I think it's not irrelevant, because the problem with the overlay is you need to keep the PV, it doesn't work alone, right? You cannot have that overlay alone, right? So from a flow perspective, you need that container disk in order to leverage this overlay functionality. What I would try to focus on is you can use that PVC. And if you go over to that persistence topic, you then discover, oh, the model is simple. I can put anything on a PV and it will be persisted, right? And use that at VMs, right? So I want to actually use the container disk as a starting point to quickly get started, but then move the focus over to persistent volumes if we go over to that persistence topic and let the user discover that the model is actually very simple, that they can then do any, you know, that they can craft the PVs in whatever way they want. They can prep, they can use Virt install or whatever to create those PVs, to have Jenkins pipelines to create them. I think to me, it's like guiding the user, right? Expanding the user's knowledge and introducing him to that new concept of PVs.
Okay. That makes sense to me. So I'm okay with that. The only way I'm okay with that is if we streamline our installation of CDI and how we message this.
Perfect. I'm fully on board. And we can discuss actually the implementation actually. You know, I think important what we hear is, I think the definite gap is that the step from container disk over to PV is too large, right? There is no friendly, user-friendly flow to do this. CDI is an option, better inclusion. I mean, there are now many options how we can improve that. To me, yeah. So, yeah.
Okay. So we're gonna make that the task. It's going to be streamlining people's first interaction with persistent virtual machines, and we'll take that offline. But I think that's something that we have to have for version one. So totally. It doesn't have to be persistent container disk volume. Doesn't have to be the way I outlined the task. Now I'll revise this.
Fabian, you mentioned that there might be other options than CDI to do this transition.
Yeah, I mean CDI has many great features, right? It has QCOW support. It has, you know, the aggregation methods are different, and so I think there's no question that we will be able to use it. The question is, I mean, there are now many questions coming to the picture, right? CDI has been standalone, but on the other tightly integrated with KubeVirt. So we could discuss pulling it in, and then we can directly leverage that functionality one way or the other, right? Maybe adding a bit more glue here and there, improving the APIs to have it even more tightly integrated. That is one option. But if we're saying we need one simple functionality of simply putting copying a container disk onto a PV, then I could imagine that KubeVirt might get a simple feature to simply copy a container disk image onto a PV. So that has to be discussed. I don't want to exclude any option. I don't want to propose any option.
Yeah. Okay. I don't want to get into the implementation of this.
Yeah.
So we have like 1 minute. I don't think we're going to get much further. We got maybe halfway. Shoot. We didn't get very far, did we?
Sorry, the topic took quite a while, but it was important.
We spent like 20 minutes. It's important to me as well. So I think through this whole discussion, the one thing that's really stood out is that our user guide and how people perceive and really encounter KubeVirt is the thing that is really important to us for version one. So before you came online, Fabian, there was a discussion about our user guide needing to be something that's just way more, way easier for people to find the information they need quickly, and maybe restructuring that and looking at that is probably priority one.
Yes. Us.
Yeah. So we didn't get very far. We have more. What do you all think about maybe just doing, I think we could probably knock this out in another meeting. Do you think we should schedule something same time next week? Does that work?
Sounds great to me.
Yep.
Okay. We'll do another one
break,
of these.
Break. 2 weeks, actually?
2 weeks.
2 weeks is good. Yeah, 2 weeks would be better because I know that some people are on PDO. And we'll be back in 2 weeks.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, 2 weeks from now, I'll put it on the community calendar and I will send out a reminder on the mailing list, and we'll talk about also in the community meeting. All right, thanks everyone. Great discussion. This has been productive for sure. I appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you, David.
Thanks, David.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, David. Bye. Bye-bye.